Welcome to my channel. I'm Scott, and if you want to catch my newest video, I post one every day. In this video, I'm going to walk you through the process of valuing BP stock by analyzing their financial statements and dissecting their financial ratios so we can determine if it's a buy or a sell. BP is an oil and gas company headquartered in London, England. It is one of the world's largest oil and gas companies. BP is vertically integrated. It operates in all the areas of the oil and gas industry. This includes exploration and production, refining, distribution and marketing, power generation and trading. It operates in 80 countries and produces 3.7 million barrels of oil per day. Let's get started with the model. This is a large cap company, 70 billion market cap. They're trading at $21 a share, and they have 3.4 billion shares outstanding. We're going to look at the ticker that trades in the United States, but this company also trades on the London Stock Exchange. Let's look at the financials. The way you value a company is you estimate the free cash flows into the future, and then you discount that number back to today's value. That's what we're doing this video. And free cash flow is cash flow from operations minus capital expenditures. And you can see the company has lots of free cash flow every year. Net income is the profit and loss on the income statement. It's revenue minus expenses. They do have positive net income in 2017, 18, and 19, but negative in the trailing 12 months. Revenue is the sales for the company, and they have lots of revenue, $240 billion up to $271 billion. It did peak in 2018 at $300 billion. And you can see their profit margins are really low, 1% to 3%. There are lots of expenses in order to run a business like this. But even 1% of $278 billion comes out to $4 billion. And this is not 1%, it just rounds to 1%. It's probably a little more than 1%. This is the company's income statement. The top line is the revenue, the sales. Below that is cost of revenue. So you can see their cost of revenue is a pretty high percentage of their revenue. Below that is their gross profit, and their gross profit seems to be decreasing from 2018. It peaked at $29 billion and it's come down quite a bit. Below that is operating expenses, which has been fairly steady over the years, $11 billion in the trailing 12 months. And their operating income is $9 billion, which is a lot lower compared to 2019 of $16 billion. They also have a good amount of debt, so they have interest payments on their debt and taxes. In the trailing 12 months, they had negative $3.3 billion of net income. In prior years, they had positive and pretty healthy net income. This was a big surprise to many analysts. They predicted the earnings would be positive. The reason they have negative earnings was due to the low oil prices. Also, their sales are down from COVID. This is the statement of cash flows, and the top line is operating cash flow. This is how much money the company generates from its operational business. So even though they had negative net income in the trailing 12 months, they still generated $21 billion of operational cash flow. Because in the income statement, there's lots of non-cash items that get passed through as expenses. But what the statement of cash flow does, it converts net income into cash. And the company has lots of capital expenditures. And to calculate free cash flow, it's operating cash flow minus CapEx. So they did have $6 billion of free cash flow in the trailing 12 months. That's still down from $10 billion in 2019. And the company's debt load is growing each year. They issued $2.5 billion of more debt in 2017, $1.8 billion extra in 2018, $1.4 billion more in 2019, and $1 billion more in a trailing 12 months. They didn't issue any capital stock, but they did repurchase $1.5 billion of capital stock in 2019. The company does pay a nice dividend, but another way to reward investors is to buy back stock. Let's look at a capital structure. They have $100 billion of equity, $77 billion of debt, but $54 billion of net debt. Net debt is total debt minus cash, and their WACC is 4.92%, which is a blend of the cost of equity and cost of debt, and that's a discount rate we're going to apply to the future cash flows. We estimated 4 years of future free cash flows. We also estimated a terminal value, which is all cash flows past year four, that's $101 billion. We discounted those numbers back to today using a weighted average cost of capital. We get a value of the company of $92 billion. We divide that by 3.4 billion shares. And we get a calculated stock price of $27. They're trading at $21, so they're trading at a 23% discount. It's a buy according to the model. Simply, Wall Street is in the other direction. They're saying the stock is worth $16. They're saying it's overvalued. It's a sell. So you could see the stock was pretty steady for a few years. It looks like it peaked at about $45, but it's come down quite a bit. It looks like it's at a really great value, at least according to my model, not according to Simply Wall Street. So the company was paying a 63 cent dividend, but they cut their dividend in half recently. They're down to 32 cents a share. Their free cash flow in the trailing 12 months was $5.9 billion, but they paid out more than that in dividends. If you take the total dividends paid over free cash flow, that's 108%. We can't look at the payout ratio because they have negative net income, but they do pay a nice dividend of 6% still. The reason the dividend is so high, even though they cut it, is because their stock price has come down so much. The way you calculate dividend yield, it's annual dividend payment over stock price. So as the stock price gets lower, the dividend yield gets higher. If you invested $10,000 into this company 10 years ago and reinvested the dividends, you'd have $8,500 today. If you did not reinvest the dividends, you'd have $9,800. The company has a pretty low beta, 0.7, so the stock moves less than the market. It's less volatile than the entire market. The stock went down 44% in the past 52 weeks, much worse than the S&P 500, which went up 16% in the same time frame. The 52-week low was $15 and the high was $40. And the stock is trading above its 50-day moving average and 200-day moving average, so it seems to be on an uptrend. And this is a pretty liquid stock. Over 11 million shares are traded each day. Almost all the shares outstanding are on float. They're available to investors. And only 8% of the shares are held by institutions, and it has a really low short percentage, 23 basis points. BlackRock is the biggest shareholder at 8%, Vanguard at 4.16%, then State Street, then the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and UBS. Let's look at the financial ratios. The average PE in the market is 12.3, the median is 14.9. PE is stock price over earnings per share. To calculate earnings per share, that's net income over shares outstanding. They have negative net income, so they have negative PE. Price to sales is stock price over sales per share. They're at 0.3, so they have a really low price to sales ratio, much better than the median and average. That means investors are paying 30 cents for $1 revenue. Price to book is stock price over book value per share. They're at 0.7, also a really low ratio. The way you calculate book value per share, it's equity over shares outstanding. Equity is assets minus liabilities on the balance sheet. That's $100 billion. Their tangible equity is $85 billion, so they have $15 billion of intangible assets on their balance sheet. Interest coverage ratio is EBIT over interest expense, so they're at 3.9, so they can easily cover their interest payments. ROE is net income over equity, negative net income, negative ROE. Current ratio is current assets over current liabilities. They're at 1.1, so they can cover their current liabilities, which is good. And their current assets are $22 billion of cash and $20 billion of inventory. And the company does seem to be well capitalized. They did have positive free cash flow in the trailing 12 months of $5.9 billion. They paid $4.3 billion of dividends, so they have enough to cover that. And they have $8.5 billion of working capital. Working capital is current assets minus current liabilities. The best way to look at ratios to compare them to similar companies, I've done videos on Cenovus, Husky, Imperial, Suncor, and Exxon, all in the same industry as BP. And if BP has a number in red, they're worse than the average. If they have a number in green, they're better than the average. So they're worse in PE because they're negative. They do have a really good price to sales ratio, but such a good ratio makes me concerned this is a value trap. They do have a good price to book ratio, but it's a little worse than the average. Their average and current ratio, they have negative ROE, but it's a little better than the average. They have the most debt of all these companies, 43% debt. And they're the second largest company on this list, $70 billion market cap. And they pay the second highest dividend at 6%. To summarize, I have them trading at a 23% discount. They seem to be operating with sufficient cash flow. And once oil prices come back up, I think their free cash flow will go even higher. This is such a big company that's involved in so many parts of the oil and gas industry. So there's not much concern for this stock. Of course, it could go down in the short term, but I think in the long run, it should be okay. So let me know what you think. Give this video a like, subscribe, or comment below. Also, if you'd like to get a custom valuation or just support the channel, you can become a member by clicking on the link in the description below. Thanks for watching.